All right, thank you for coming tonight, and some are still arriving. And this is a air and sometimes why series, and a four-night series of about AI, basically. And my name is Yutaka Takiura. I'm a professor teaching at the Design Management Program in Manhattan. And it's howling? No, good, okay, all right. So tonight is the third night of four nights, and AI through our lens. And I'm gonna let them introduce themselves and the amazing speakers tonight. You guys are lucky. And next week is the final fourth week, and human emotion and machine, and Natalie will talk. So please come back next week. And that's it. So please introduce yourself. And
hello, everyone. My name is Christopher Vitale. I'm going to be hosting and moderating tonight. I'm an associate professor in the Graduate School of Media Studies, well, graduate program in media studies. We're not a school yet. But we're in our fifth year of the master's program here, so we're quite excited about it. So today I'd like to introduce Sandra and Byron. I'll have you say a few words about yourselves, and please introduce yourselves.
Hi everyone, my name is Sandra Atakara. I graduated from the Master's of Industrial Design program here at Pratt in the spring, and I'll be talking a little bit about my thesis project and how it relates to AI, and in particular also augmented reality.
Hello everybody, I did not go to school at Pratt. I have industry experience in the music industry. I am a former music label exec, currently in the digital landscape now, doing a lot of consulting work. I'll be talking about AI integration into music production, as well as music discovery.
Okay, thank you so much. So each of us is gonna give a brief talk, about 8 to 10 minutes, and then we'll open up for a panel. So, yeah, I guess.
Can I sit there?
Oh, do y'all wanna sit? That's fine.
I think we're gonna do the presentation.
Which would you prefer?
You can start talking.
Okay.
Please.
Yes. Okay. Have a seat, folks, and then we will begin.
Name matches.
Yes.
In your case.
Yes.
Okay. I hope you don't mind. Thank you. It's incredibly hot. All right. So to start off, so our topic today is through a lens. That's our theme, and I'm going to start off, these are the notes for my talk, if anyone's interested. I don't use PowerPoint because I like to be a teacher, so contact with the audience for me is very important. But I'm going to start off today showing us some examples of passive dynamic walkers. And the reason why, first I want to talk about why through a lens, right? The notion of a lens, obviously, is something that you see through, it's a medium. And as part of the Media Studies program here at Pratt, Media Studies is a large part of what we do, obviously. And Aristotle famously says in his discussion of the word medium, right, his use of the word meta, he says, hopefully that's a little better. Our topic, as I said, was through a lens. We're discussing what it would mean to look at AI through a particular lens, to see it as a particular type of lens. And I would start to narrate this brief little quip from Aristotle, where he famously says, in what is often thought to be one of the origins of the word media in a certain sense, that the fish that swims in the water does not realize the water is there because it is the medium through which it partakes of the world, right? That the water is so almost invisible, it can't kind of, just like air, it's like the air we breathe. Right? In some sense, the notion of media has a very wide set of potential meanings. And so when we think of AI as a potential medium of the future, a potential lens on the future, there's so many different ways in which all of this can be seen as playing out. So if we think of AI through a particular lens, this is a type of view of AI. It's about how we see AI and how that could influence perhaps the way AI develops in the future. Now, there's a philosopher, Gilles Deleuze, philosophy is my own personal background, who speaks of the notion of an image of thought. Right? For Deleuze, we imagine thought and thinking through particular lenses. We have images of what the brain is, and what the brain does, and what it could be doing in the future. And so when we say, oh, the brain is like a computer, I know growing up, that was said to me quite often. Right, my teachers, elementary school, high school, they all said, oh, the brain's like a computer. And when I pushed a little further, they were just like, well, you know, computer's a thing with binary switches and it goes real fast. And DNA is like binary code. And they, you know, presented all sorts of little diagrams of DNA, and it all was made to look like binary switches and things of that sort. But scientists are increasingly realizing that DNA is not a binary code. If anyone knows the word epigenesis, epigenetics, this is the study of how DNA is actually a dynamic network of relays, and all sorts of ways in which our environment acts upon us, we then, you know, our DNA responds in a dynamic way. It's not a prefixed code in any way, shape, or form. It's something that literally relates to the environment. And so studying the DNA code that we have as a network, as much as the network of the brain, this is the increasing image of thought and thinking, which is increasingly replacing much of that that says that the brain is some sort of computer that's just not as fast as the things that are on our desktops or in our Palm Pilots and now smartphones of various sorts. Previously, people may have said, oh, the brain is not a computer. They said, oh, the brain is like a hydraulic heat engine of some sort. Right, and this was Freud's model of the mind. It was very much, oh, it's got these pressures and it pushes down here and rises up in pressure there, and then your oppression gives way and all of these things come to the surface and bubble up like a cauldron. Right, that's another, it's more hydraulic model of the mind. Previously, before that, people said, oh, the brain is like a machine engine. It's like a car engine, it's like even a clockwork. Right? And so in the time of Rene Descartes, people were thinking, oh, the brain is like just a very complicated watch with gears and things of that sort. They were thinking of what it means to think along the lines of these images of thought. Certainly when I grew up, it was the brain is a binary computer. But now that is starting to change as people start to realize that maybe we can make computers on the image of the brain rather than vice versa. Right? It used to be, oh, well, brains just aren't as good as these various things. If only people could be more like computers, we would be smarter, we would be quicker, we would be faster, we would be more accurate. Certainly, I know doing long division in elementary school, my brain didn't like doing that. And computers are so good at that. They're so incredibly fast. But if you say to a computer, can you just move out of my way? Even if the computer can move, you're going to confuse the hell out of it. Right? That's Wittgenstein's famous example from his philosophical investigations of the types of commands that are very often used by humans, but frustrate binary types of logical thinking. If you say, just move over there, instead of, can you please move this particular angle, this particular distance? That a computer will understand just fine. But if you say, move right over there, that's fuzzy. That's the type of thing human brains work great at. And if you try to take our fastest computers today and give them fuzzy commands, most of them have enormous difficulty. So we're starting to realize that perhaps we are not just slow, imprecise machines. Perhaps to get the next stage of machines, we need a new image of thought, a new type of way of thinking about what thought, thinking, and even computation can be. And maybe we need computers that are more like brains. Well, this is a lot of what I do for my own work. A little shameless self-promotion for a moment. First book, Networkologies, Philosophy of Networks, published by Zero Books. The next book is coming out by Zero Books, should be out by 2018. That's NetWorlds, a relational philosophy of the networks of experience. It's all about why networks can explain the everyday life. And then the big book I've been working on for quite a while, it's called The Networked Mind. It's already got like 400 footnotes in it. It doesn't have a publisher yet. That one is The Networked Mind, Artificial Intelligence, Soft Non-Binary Computing, and the Futures of Philosophy. A soft computer is one that does not use ones and zeros. And increasingly, this is one of the directions where computation is going. Things like Facebook's facial recognition algorithm, things like Siri, all of these use artificial neural networks. These are computers that are simulated brains, and they work in simulation, they're like video game platforms with little virtual neurons, and you network them together, and you don't program them. You teach them like children. When it gets something wrong, you don't reward it, you punish it. And when it gets something right, you do reward it. And what is rewarded is the particular pathway in the virtual brain. And a reward is to say to that virtual pathway, grow stronger. So you start out with a relatively random assortment of connections, and when something works, you reinforce it. It's called reinforcement learning. It's what we do with children. And you teach the neural network, and it gets smarter and learns over time. Of course, the teacher needs to know what they're doing, but humans teach their kids all the time, right? So you just need somebody who can teach the computer. And so with Facebook's facial recognition algorithm, they had computers teaching computers. They had the rigid types of computers, the types that are on your desktop, that are very good at saying, does this match or does it not match? Well, they taught the computer that was wired like a brain. When it got one little thing right, it said, yes, that is a match. Grow that connection stronger. And so the trainers can be humans or the trainers can be desktop computers. I want to show you why computation is changing, and the clearest example I can think of is to show you a passive dynamic walker. This is a type of computer. It is a physical computer. By the way, I also teach the artificial intelligence class here at Pratt. This is some of the stuff we do, so if you're a graduate student here, undergraduate, it's cross-listed, take AI next semester. This is a passive dynamic walker. It is a physical computer. You'll notice that there is no CPU, there's no electronics of any sort, no sensors, nothing. It is just limbs and gears, and that's it. And it is powered not by electricity or motors or anything of the sort, but by gravity. So the incline of this tiny little treadmill is what makes it go. I'll show you another example of a passive dynamic walker. This is a slightly more complicated one. And people who work in physical computation will say that the limbs are producing computation for free. And what they mean by that is that with the right body, you need much less microprocessor. And you can actually equate how much microprocessing power, memory, energy, computation time you save with the right body, which means that the right body is equivalent to so much computation that you don't have to do. Or if you do it beforehand. Here is a class at the University of Pennsylvania, and their project was to design a passive dynamic walker. They have a nifty soundtrack, which is melodramatic. They had 5 weeks to design a passive dynamic walker, and here you see their prototypes. And you see them failing. This is what evolution does, biological evolution. And this is why increasingly evolution is being seen as a type of computation. It's referred to as genetic or evolutionary computation. Now you can do the computation with all these equations beforehand, right? And this is the stuff that is saved by the right body. You don't have to do this sort of stuff, and you don't need a CPU to do it if you have the right body. Now designing the right body may take equations, or it may take the trial and error of biological evolution, or human evolution, trial and error, until you get, after various prototypes, this thing. And you see, it doesn't quite do it the first few times. But then, oh, sorry, wait, it does it at the end. There it goes. Okay. You can see the process going on here. So the statement I want to make before I leave y'all today, which I will put on the whiteboard over here because I'm a teacher and I like whiteboards. Hi. Is that the future of AI, I believe, and the future of computing will not be digital. This is a strong statement, I realize, but I believe it will be instead soft organic, embodied, evolutionary, and emergent. Now, some of this is similar to what is often referred to as the four E's of the new cognitive science. Let me just go over what this means. It's slightly different, but it's a modified version. This soft means non-binary, between ones and zeros. This is often referred to as fuzzy logic, fuzzy mathematics, or various forms of fuzzy systems if you study various forms of soft computing. Organic means that instead of having computers that try to resemble very fast binary switches and relay machines, they will instead start resembling organisms. Third, they'll be embodied, like our passive dynamic walker. To get the right type of intelligence, you need the right type of body. And that requires thinking through what your task is. Rather than, as Turing said, coming up with a universal machine, you come up with a much more specific machine that has evolved to your task. Evolutionary, thinking of evolution as a type of computation, as a computational search algorithm, and then very often using evolution to come up with solutions and generate them for you. And emergent means it generates from its own environment, like an organism does. So instead of programming computers, we grow them or we teach them. That's my presentation, folks. Anyway, Sandra, I believe you're up next, so here you go.
Thank you, and thank you for your great presentation. Just load up here. You're using this computer? I'm using this computer.
Oh, yeah.
It was for Trevor. You should just get like, the laptop button.
Just yes. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Sandra, and yeah, I want to start this presentation with a little bit of a disclaimer. And that is because when I was invited to come speak here and I heard it was about AI, my first thought was, I don't know that much about AI. I do, however, know something about AR, augmented reality. This is what I did my thesis project on. And I think that by sharing my process of working on this project, I think that it might be relevant to, like, this way that I'm learning to work with emerging technologies might also apply to AI. And once I finish the presentation, you'll also see that there are some really relevant connections between this AR project and AI. So hopefully it will make sense. So part of this process of designing for augmented reality was not actually starting with the technology, but with the problem. So this is where my project started, in a supermarket. And I had just moved to the US and I didn't know any of the brands. And I thought, like, how am I supposed to make a decision? Like, what do I buy? And I wanted to make my decision based on facts. So instead of just looking at all of this, I started looking at this, all the nutrition labels. And what I saw was something like this, a lot of information that I couldn't really balance or compare didn't really help me in terms of making a decision. So I asked myself, what if there was a different way to display this? What if it didn't have to be this way? And what if instead of seeing this, we could see something like this? And that eventually became sort of the problem statement for my thesis project. Expanding this problem to not just myself, but in general, how can we empower consumers to make more fact-based decisions when they shop for food? And it's just so happened that my thesis advisor, Henry Yu, who was the director of the Digital Arts and Humanities Research Center, introduced me to this just about a year ago. This is the HoloLens from Microsoft. It's an augmented reality display, for those of you who don't know it. And I was so impressed with this technology, and I immediately knew that that was like something I could use to make this go to something like this. So I started prototyping in augmented reality, first on mobile platform. So I developed something like this, being able to see the serving size. I went on to explore how you develop for HoloLens, and I think I didn't have any experience with this at all. So it just like jumped into it, and I think this is another important thing about designing with new technologies is that there's so much information about it out there. So it's like fairly easy to get into it once you decide to do that, which is maybe the harder part. So once I started developing for this, instead of having the phone, this is shot through the HoloLens, you would just see something like this through the display, which eventually became this. So the idea here was that you can see this display that's much larger, gives a better overview than what you just see on the side of a cereal box. However, of course, there are some digital platforms that already do things like this. We have MyFitnessPal, there are various apps, online platforms. So I also had to ask myself, what are the benefits of using AR for this? Can I just do like a normal phone app? What I discovered was, first of all, the advantage of having a volumetric display becomes really important when you want to try and visualize volumetric amounts, such as the serving size. So that was the first thing. Second is that when you use augmented reality, especially off the phone, on the phone, you only have this much of a display. But if you use something like the HoloLens, essentially this becomes your canvas for displaying information. So I thought that was a huge advantage as well. And finally, you will be able to provide the information right there on site, because it's actually triggered by the front of the cereal boxes, so there's no like going online and searching. It just appears right there. So those were the advantages of working in augmented reality. Then I asked myself, what are the potential implications of working in AR? And I came across this video, which is pretty much summarizes everything I don't like about augmented reality and a world that I don't want to see. So this also became guiding in how I move forward in the design process. Another obvious issue with AR is this. Right now, I don't think that people want to go to the supermarket wearing something like this, and even Google Glass, which had a much smaller like form factor, was not wildly successful. So to really address this problem, I started thinking about what's another type of device, like how are we going to interact with augmented reality in the future? And I started investigating like different things that we wear or have like, close to our head, on our face, and like, kind of analyzing them in terms of their like the etiquette that they come with and also the metaphors that they provide. And eventually, the concept device that I designed is this. I called it the Loop, and it would work something like this. So you go to the supermarket, and you look through it to see a display of information. And as you can see, it has the shape of the magnifying glass, which we know from Sherlock Holmes. We also know it from kind of online shopping. And what I found was that this metaphor of the magnifying glass was so strong. It came with all these connotations of discovery, inspection, searching, and filtering, which was exactly what I was trying to do in a supermarket. So just a little bit of how this device would work. It would be a transparent display that you can then turn on. You could use it in any orientation. And the way that you would interact with it in the supermarket would be kind of in three steps. So first, you define your search criteria. Am I allergic to something? What are the criteria that I have for the like food that I'm looking for? Second, you would search through the supermarket, kind of scanning to find the matches. And then third, inspect information closer of the products that you're interested in. So the way that would work is that you would use the interface to define your criteria, and then once you're in the supermarket, take out your Loop and then scan over to see the matches. And then finally, kind of expand that information to see this display of nutrition facts. Yeah, so that was my concept device. And of course, it's hard to say. Like, the technology for making this kind of thing it probably exists, but it's hard to get it down into this form factor. And it was more like an exploration of how we might interact with technology in the future. And I find that often when we're designing with new technologies, people tend to become very dystopian or very idealistic. And I wanted to kind of just not have any like limitations of what the market might dictate and so on. So that's why I designed this. But that being said, to realize a concept like this, the first step would probably be designing for the phone. So I also explored the concept of that. So then it would be something like this. And that's something that we can do already. This is an app that is running. And then once you're finding the product that you want to inspect, you can see the nutrition facts shown in augmented reality. So this is when I want to kind of circle back to AI, because I think like advances in AI and computer visions are what are going to make a concept like this kind of realizable or feasible. But that also means that when you think about when we're seeing these check marks and X's, what is it like? What are the decisions that we want to be made beforehand? How much control do we want? Because with AI, there's the potential of having algorithms that kind of learn the products that you like, or and will give you suggestions based on that. So do we actually want that, or do we want to just input our own criteria? How much convenience do we want? And I think about it in like relation to like Netflix or all these other like media platforms that we interact with, where they show us sort of curated content, which is nice and convenient, but might also take some control away from us. So it's also a matter of how you phrase this question, like how much help would you want, or how much assistance would you want? Yeah, thank you.
All right, thank you, Sandra. Byron.
Okay, technological music advances and AI integration. So I'm going to start off with a little cliche. Music is a universal language. As with almost all things in the world, how we produce and consume music changes along with the advancements of technology. I'm going to give a brief history of a few advances within the music industry and go into the integration of AI into our lives. 1877, Thomas Edison created the phonograph. This gave us the ability to physically record music on cylinders and play it back. 1888, gramophone was created. Along with it came the vinyl. The vinyl was much more cost-effective to make, as well as being easier for consumers to use. It wasn't until the mid-1900s that the vinyl became affordable and more mainstream, along with the FM radio. Cassette tapes became popular in the 1960s and held a stronghold on the market until the introduction of the compact disc. FYI, the first commercially released CD was Billy Joel in 1982. Believe it or not. Music production during this time involved large costs, which included renting studio time, staffing, and equipment. And according to the RIAA, the CD reached peak popularity in the year 2000 when CD players replaced cassette players as a standard equipment, replacing cassette players as standard equipment in cars and handheld devices. In the mid-90s, MP3s were created, but had very little fanfare. During this time, of the CD Renaissance, a little-known company launched Napster, as you can see, and it disrupted the industry, allowing people to understand that they could consume music digitally for the first time, or actually popularized the concept of listening to MP3s of their favorite music. This helped popularize the format, and more people understood that basically you had the fingertips, you have music at your fingertips. The places where people could listen to their music, obviously, at this time with the advent of MP3s, were the computers and your handheld devices, which basically you have the first generation iPad there. I don't know how many of you guys have actually seen one of those, but we all now consume everything from our iPhones. Numerous computer programs gave artists the flexibility to create music from home studios, thus paving the way for new AI integrations. So, you know, and when you look here, from the previous slide, you saw massive studios, you saw a massive staff. Now people are able to actually find programs and create music from their homes. And so with that came the ability to use more popular tools, more AI tools for music production. The first program is Google's NSYNC. This is a program that was created by Google Magenta's team that basically created new sounds by crossbreeding instruments that they've recorded. So from here, you can see they took a harp and the clarinet. I can't give a live demonstration, but you can Google NSYNC, and you can actually play around with the experiment online. The next project was IBM Watson. So I'm sure you guys are all familiar with IBM Watson, how it competed in Jeopardy a while back. They actually have IBM Watson Beat, which takes existing music, scans music sites, and social media to help you write lyrics to music. And one producer by the name of Alex the Kid actually produced a song called Not Easy, which peaked on the Billboard chart, number 6 on the digital chart and 48 on the rock chart. He has a little video just to show his music process, the creative process. So I'm going to play this for you.
I found music when I was 19, and it completely changed everything. My perspective, my friends, just the way I looked at the world, and it just made me a different person. It's absolutely everything in my life. I'm Alex the Kid, and I've been told to say I'm a Grammy Award winning producer. I love understanding human emotions because it's very complex. You know, why people feel the way they feel, what actions they take based on that feeling. My favorite question to ask people is why.
I take inspiration from all different types of places, but ultimately it's just from living life.
When we first met Alex, he was interested in exploring culture and music on a deeper, more emotional level.
When we talk about illuminating data, what we mean is that we're visualizing it in a way that we can understand it and relate to it.
Very impressive.
In culture, Watson analyzed millions of lines of text, Wikipedia articles, New York Times front pages, social media, blogs, and more, finding the most pervasive themes and uncovering the way people felt about them. Watson also analyzed the lyrics and composition of over 26,000 top 100 Billboard songs, uncovering hidden patterns in both song structure and emotion.
It's almost like having a million of yourself reading a million books at once and a million articles and understanding social media and just conversation in general. I could never do that.
Once Alex began the music making process, we gave him a prototype of something we're developing called Watson Beat. It understands and deconstructs music and then allows artists to change it based on the moods they want to express.
I always say I don't really play instruments that well. I play the laptop extremely well. Technology is paramount, definitely, to my process. And being able to collaborate with Watson, it just took everything to another level. The
data from Watson showed me all these heavy emotions millions of people felt around the world. Then I kind of started thinking about heartbreak and just how it's so universal and how everyone goes through it on some level. So it's a very uniting thing. Hopefully when this is being sung by, you know, 60,000 people in a stadium, everyone's singing the same lyric, but they're all singing about something slightly different. But they're all there as a community, kind of feeling each other's pain in a joyous way. Working with Watson's been great because it allowed me to create something that I probably would never have done without him.
So as you can see, it's a pretty good song. Yeah. Part of the theme that I've been talking about is a collaborative effort, the AI and musicians. A lot of conversations I've had with people, it tends to veer off of, okay, when does the AI take over and just start making music? But at this point, and what we've all, you know, decided or come to conclusion is, you're not going to have the emotion, you're not going to have the human experience and the context to be able the AI won't be able to do that, at least not, you know, in the near time future. So it's more of a collaborative effort. So a lot of these programs you're going to see is people are using it to help create music, you're helping them write lyrics, and it's just a matter of it's going to be a collaborative, more collaborative effort, and not necessarily AI is going to take over the top 100, you know, charts. The next music program is called Amper Music. This is another collaborative tool where artists work with computers to create compositions. This year, American Idol alum Taryn Southern has become a pioneer in using multiple AI programs to create her entire album, due out later this year. With Amper Music, she created her first commercially released single called Break Free. She gave the program some guidelines, such as the speed of the song, the pitch, key signature, and preferred instruments. And then basically the program produced a track for her to use, and she laid her lyrics on top of that. She's been quoted as saying, writing the structure of a song is now 20 times faster than working with a human. As the gift that you see here was actually from her video of the same song, and she also used an AI program for that as well called Deep Dream Generator. Next up is the Flow Machines. This is created by Sony Labs, the ability to take any existing musical style and then adapt it into a new composition. So basically drawing on Sony's vast melody and harmony database. An example of this work is called Daddy's Car, which can be found on YouTube. This song was made in the style of the Beatles. It currently has over 1.7 million views in a little over a year. Juke Deck. This is a program that a lot of YouTubers use. And with this, people can create original, customized, royalty-free music. For those who don't know, it's really a cumbersome process or expensive process to use licensed music. You go to, I won't say AP, but I forget the names of the companies, but they have databases of royalty-free music that you can purchase. This is actually a cheaper version of that, and the music is created within 15 seconds. So it's basically, you put in the requirements that you're looking for, and it spits out royalty-free music that you can actually use as your background soundtrack to a video that you make for YouTube. Here's their little quick
edit. Duke Deck provides unique, personalized music at the touch of a button. With Duke Deck, you can customize, create, and download your unique royalty-free soundtrack in seconds. Duke Deck. Soundtracks reimagined.
And another program I have, or basically, is called Weave Music. So we all love Homer Simpson. So with Weave Music, this is more of a contextual kind of mobile app. And with that, basically, it's adaptive. So say, for example, you're listening to music and you're running. So the music speeds up as you speed up. It slows down if you start to walk. So this takes more of an adaptive approach in real time as far as the music that you're listening to. And how they produce that is basically, it's a lot of pitch control and speed controls that's done in the studio ahead of time, and then basically build a rich database so the computer can tell, you know, your movement. Next up, music discovery and personalization. Streaming platforms are becoming a new popular way in how we consume music. Pandora, launched in 2000, is currently the largest in the US. Next came Apple Music. This launched in 2003, and then you have the worldwide juggernaut right now, Spotify, which launched in 2006, but didn't hit the US until 2011. Each platform uses AI in varying degrees. Pandora created Thumbprint Radio in 2015. This creates playlists based off of your personalized interactions with Pandora. Every time you click the thumbs up button, it builds its database and makes it more personalized for your experience. They also recently acquired Ticketfly, which basically helped them build an AI-based concert recommendation platform. So I don't know if you've ever experienced or signed up, but when an artist announces a show in your town, and it knows that you've listened or you thumbed up anything on Pandora, then you're going to get that email from the artist saying, hey, these tickets are going on sale. So the next up was Apple Music. They use it the least. They use AI the least, at least for now. Their claim to fame, or what they tout, is human curation by celebrities and DJs. The aspect of them using AI is on their Your Music option. So they put it behind a paid wall, but before then it was called the Genius Playlist. So, but now it's with this, it's also it asks you for your personal, you know, your likes, you know, the different artists that you like, the type of music that you like, and it creates that playlist for you. Last, Spotify. This uses a collaboration of humans and AI programs that basically help create their playlist. The humans and the AI work together, they collaborate to create their playlists, such as Rap Caviar, which is one of the largest. These programs have real-time data of the listeners and how the songs are reacting, and which gives the human programmers the ability to stay relevant, keep the playlist fresh, keep the playlist timely. When they lean more on the AI side, they use the Discover Weekly playlist. That is basically every 2 weeks, or every Monday, I should say, they generate a two-hour playlist specifically tailored for the music listener's taste. With this, it combines musical preference of the listener, popular songs that are enjoyed by other listeners that the program may think that you might like as well. Another example is a daily mix. It basically goes upon your listening history as you're going across a platform. And the last, what they most recently announced, was Spotify Time Capsule. And with that, this takes the music preferences and the listener's age. And then what it goes back to your teens and your early 20s and creates, you know, a playlist of basically reminiscent, you know. And I've actually given it a whirl a few times, and I'm very surprised. It's pretty spot on. Please note I left off YouTube, as they haven't disclosed much of their AI for use of video and audio content at the moment. But we all know that that's another streaming, that's the largest streaming platform in the world. Early tools of music composition, or music consumption, I should say, with AI integration, besides our computers and smartphones, are smart speakers. I don't know about you, but I love new technology. As soon as something comes out, I get it. And so I bought the Amazon Echo last January, I believe it was. But it was very limited. It's just like, okay, put this on my lists. You know, Amazon, tell me a joke. Amazon, play, you know, Pandora Radio. And so it wasn't really it didn't have a lot of bells and whistles. So what these companies have started to do, you know, you have the Google Home that came out as well, and then the other speakers, Sonos, they now integrate with, I believe it's Amazon Echo as well. And then Apple has a smart speaker. So basically, Google has taken a lead in this area where they serve, that speaker can serve as your control center to play video and audio in your home. So for example, you can say, Google Home, play Stranger Things from Netflix on my smart TV. And it, all of a sudden your television comes up and you're watching Stranger Things. Doorbell rings, Google Home, pause. Go get your food delivered, you know? Sit down and start eating, Google Home Play. And so it's a lot more interactive with not just, you know, your music playlist, but anything else within your home. Amazon Echo, not so much. You need a third party program or hardware to actually help do the same things as Google Home does. But I know that they just released the new line of equipment. So I'm sure that that's going to supposedly alleviate that issue. What next? Well, according to the recent report by IHS, the install rate of AI-based systems in new vehicles was only 8% in 2015. When you think about that, that was only 2 years ago, only 8% of new cars have AI programs in them. That number is forecasted to rise to 109% in the year 2025. That's 7 years from now. That means there's going to be multiple AI programs within these new cars. Several major companies are already racing to be a part of that. You know, you have Google, you have Uber, Apple, Spotify, and you have the automakers. These concepts include speech and gesture recognition, eye tracking, virtual assistants, driver monitoring, and the one that's been most prevalent in the news, autonomous driving. So think about how music experience could fit into this. The moment you get in your car, it recognizes your phone, and then the car asks you, do you want to finish that podcast you're listening to while you're walking to the car? Or do you want to play a new, you know, and listen to the new Eminem album that just came out today? Another example would be the car senses your distress. You're driving, you're aggressive driving, it's reading your biometrics. All of a sudden, the music changes and it's playing a little Chopin. It's calming you down, and you know, it's keeping you from that road rage that you get. Or based on your GPS, the car could sense that you're driving up PCH, Pacific Coast Highway, and it notices that it could put on some cruiser music as you're going down the coast. You're just relaxing and enjoying the sun with your rooftop down. And so the idea is to really have the car, you know, I wouldn't say the idea, but the concepts are really have the car a lot more intuitive to the driver and to your entire experience. And again, that's collaborative. It doesn't take over the experience of driving, but it enhances the experience of driving. Basically, to wrap things up, we're only scratching the surface of AI integration into our lives. Integration into music is no different. The collaborative tools to make and listen to music are nascent at best. New hardware and software have yet to be created for a more contextual experience. When this eventually happens, we could potentially have our favorite music serve as the soundtrack of our lives at every waking moment.
So I guess we'll start off with a bit of a roundtable discussion, and then we'll open up to audience questions. Just looking at and listening to everyone's really excellent presentations, one thing that struck me was the degree of interactivity that everyone indicated, that AI was not seen as necessarily something that would be doing all the thinking for us, but rather something we interact with, or that it somehow augments our experience. Can either of you say a little bit more about your thoughts about how that you think will play out, or why that could be, the ramifications of that?
Sure. Well, the way I look at it, when I, you know,
when I first learned of AI, it was like, oh my God, this is amazing. This is, you know, the car's gonna drive, it's wonderful, and I can just sit back and it's gonna take me to places. And then, you know, as you start really thinking about it, you know, my first thought was, crap. I mean, they're gonna take over. Terminator, you know, this is gonna happen. but as I started to really, you know, delve into it and talk to different people, it really, I view it as more of a utopian experience where it's just going to benefit our lives. It's just going to extend the experience, enhance the experience, where, you know, how many of us love to sit in traffic? You know, I don't think anyone here wants to sit in traffic and deal with the stop and go. But if you're able to still be in the driver's seat and then say, you know, turn on the AI or let the AI take over while you're in traffic, I mean, I wouldn't mind driving to the Hamptons or out of town, getting stuck in 2-hour traffic just to get out of New York City. So I think that that will be the general consensus, I think, is people are looking for ways to make life more convenient. You know, we're always looking for the most convenient ways. And I think that make it convenient, but don't take it over. And I feel that people are, that's just, you know, human nature's is you want things how you want it, when you want it.
Do you have thoughts?
Yeah, and along the same lines as Byron, the way I think about working with emerging technologies.
Is there any way we could turn the mic down a little? Thank you so much. Yeah.
I see technology in general and also AI as a tool, so something that that helps us in our daily lives. And I can see that there would be, there's definitely the possibility that AI can become something that makes decisions of its own, but I think it's up to us to kind of decide when that happens. Mm-hmm. And at least, like, my kind of hope for the future is that it's not gonna be too much like us just kind of getting rid of all responsibilities and letting kind of computers make decisions for us, but that we are very aware of when we decide to interact with technology, and that it's kind of on our terms. That's the way I see it. I think the same with kind of AR, that instead of having it be so ubiquitous that, like, I don't necessarily want to have AR glasses. I don't think I need to see an overlay of information all the time. So kind of like that, having some very like clear ways of separating when are we interacting and when are we not. That's my
I mean, I've got to say, I would probably take the opposite tack from both of you in some ways. The more I learn about the technologies, the more I write about them, the more scared I become. And I think, you know, I'll give you an example. The U.S. Department of Defense has a drone strike program that uses artificial neural networks, which is the technology that I'm quite interested in. And what they do is they take patterns of known terrorist strikes, and then they feed them into the neural network, and all a neural network does, at least your standard neural networks, is look for patterns, mm-hmm. right? So the neural network that is used to recognize our faces in Facebook, Google did it first, but then Facebook came out with their facial recognition algorithm. But that algorithm, basically, it will learn whatever you give it and whatever you reward it to learn. And so they took these artificial neural networks, they fed them pattern after pattern of known terrorist strikes, and the movement that the people made in their recent weeks before they made those strikes. And then what they do is they feed in satellite photo data back into these neural networks and see when they get a match. And when they get a match, they send a drone and the drone goes and kills people. And so what happens is the drone strike will basically look, well, if your normal fruit selling route in Afghanistan is to go from this town to this town to this town, and it just happens to match up with what a terrorist did when he was collecting arms right before he set off an explosion, you could be targeted by a drone strike. So now we have a sort of arms race where people are trying to wonder which of my actions might look like a terrorist's actions to a satellite taking photos of me, and how do I not do that? And then you have people then trying to do sorts of, you know, terrorist activities or, you know, military activities of some sort or another, trying to then imitate what a fruit seller might do, right? Or vice versa. So it's this weird situation where, I mean, the Department of Defense is all about AI, but I think sometimes also when you don't always know when you're dealing with AI. So for example, going back to music, I make music in my spare time and I use Logic's virtual drummer. So you had Logic up there before. And I'm thrilled because the virtual drummer program allows me to not need a real drummer. And if you're recording music, I mean, having a real drummer is actually really, that's one of the most expensive things. You gotta mic them upright and stuff. And here I could just say, okay, play faster, play slower, but it's not actually AI. It appears like AI, you interact with it like AI, but all they did was had a real drummer play a zillion patterns and they chopped it up and put it into a nice interface. But it acts like AI. Whereas some things that you think might not be AI actually is AI. Like for example, I mean, we probably all realize that Siri has some form of AI in there, but it's actually in order to parse our speech. It's not in the answering of the questions necessarily. It's actually really difficult for computers to recognize our speech. But, you know, stuff like the facial recognition algorithm, you would think that perhaps like, oh, you know, that's just matching. But that actually was one of the biggest difficulties for AI to sort of conquer. So I think one of the problems is how do we know when we're even dealing with AI? So anyway, that's a whole bunch of issues to throw back at y'all.
Yeah, no, I think if I can slide.
Go ahead.
I'm definitely also scared or at least cautious. I went recently to NYC Media Lab, the demo day, and there was a panel discussion also about AI, and one of the panelists said, who clearly knew much more about how the technology works than I do, said, we don't actually know how deep neural networks work, we just know that they work. And I thought that was like...
That's debatable, but okay.
Yeah, but like, they say they know how they work, but not why, is how she said.
Well, there's no code.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
So it's like
it,
you
can't... And you look inside and you're like, that looks like a brain.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think that was kind of an eye-opener to me. And I think that one of the big challenges, and I'm seeing all this from kind of the design perspective, is like how can we design more transparency into these systems so that people actually, like you were saying, understand like when are they dealing with something that's making decisions on their behalf, and what are the types of decisions being made? Because I think also there's a huge difference between, you know, deciding to like take an action of sorts, like you said about shooting like a missile, of course, like a huge thing, compared to like parsing your speech or whatever. Like there's so many different applications of AI, and some of them to me are fairly harmless and other have huge implications. And I think that we're so used to this idea of just kind of the magic box seamless integration of technology and all of it, our devices. So I'm interested in seeing how we as designers can design more transparency into the objects that we interact with.
I think just to talk about the drone strike concept, I mean, yes, it's studying the patterns, it's realizing, oh, this looks like a terrorist pattern, but it's not pulling the trigger. It needs a human to pull the trigger. So again, yeah, it's more collaborative. Now, granted, it may learn how to circumvent the human at some point, but right now, it's collaborative. I mean, it says this is the pattern.
It requires that person to authorize.
Yeah, yeah. And so that person or team or whatever the case may be. So, but it's doing the research in the X degree of speed that a human could actually do, and then it's reporting back to the human. Yeah, this is a pattern. What do you think? Give us a command. So, it boils back down to a collaborative effort. But yes, it is kind of scary on that front, just to think that, you know, computers can actually, you know, have that thought pattern, have that recognition. But again, I think it's going to be a more collaborative.
And I guess the thing that scares me is if we do take the humans out of the loop, right? If we just have the computer decide on its own, well, it looks like a terrorist pattern, and it calls the drone strike.
But then that's us being lazy as humans. You know, that's like, okay, you know, I don't want to do this job anymore, you do it. It's like, you know, at some point, we can't be lazy.
Well, this brings me to my second question a bit, which is the issue of people being replaced, right? So like one of the things I really like about the virtual drummer in Logic is that I don't need to work with the drummer anymore. I can make music in my bedroom. Right. And my drummer friends are like, oh, Well, why did I spend years learning this instrument? Now, they're coming up with more and more of these virtual instruments, and so they have, like, if you look at native instruments, they now have, like, sitar player and rock guitar player and country music player, and you can buy chopped up, you know, really great guitarists or sitar players, and they just chop up their performances into all these little bits, and then you can interact with it like you would an AI to say, well, I want you to play this, I want you to have this intonation. And so I'm wondering, will anyone learn how to play guitar or sitar in the future? Will everyone just learn how to play laptop? And I'm wondering, are we going to put, like, I was thinking of, you know, something like Loop. Will this put nutritionists out of business? Is that a bad thing? You know, just like this could put drummers out of business. So I'm wondering what you both think about that. Mm-hmm. Or should we care?
Of course we should care. Yeah, definitely. I think, I mean, with any kind of evolvement of technology, some jobs fade away and new jobs appear, if we're speaking about jobs. So I think, I mean, that's the way it has been always, right? There, and that enables us to do so many, like, more things. I think there's a big difference between, like, taking away jobs such as nutritionists and then not having people learn how to drum. I think those are very separate. Being a drummer can also be a job, so I understand. But I do think that people will still want to learn things that they enjoy for the sake of doing them. Maybe through technology there's more, like, sort of access for people to learn different instruments. I mean, I'm not sure. Yes, we should definitely care.
Okay.
Yeah.
I agree. I mean, we definitely should care. I think that we need to evolve as technology evolves. You know, a lot of, you know, our 9-to-5 is set on the industrial age of back, you know, and you know, the manufacturing plants, you know, the daylight savings times, farmers. So it's, we haven't evolved as basically of, we haven't evolved as fast as technology has as far as how we need to rethink what our job should be. You know, our jobs, yes, like you said, some jobs will go away, but that creates newer jobs. Now, that we haven't done a very good job as a society of pushing people to these new jobs, of educating them, like, listen, you know, when I was a kid, we didn't have computers, but now there's computers. Now there's opportunities to be a computer engineer or create, you know, an AI program. We didn't even know what AI was when I was in high school. So I think nowadays it's really, you know, moving forward and evolving basically our skill set to evolve with the times and evolve with the technology.
So I'm curious, do either of you have questions for each other?
Really
questions for me? I don't know. But we could turn it over to the audience if either of you have questions.
I'm curious about your answer to your own question about the loss of jobs, technology advances.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think, you know, as you said, technology is constantly, you know, putting people out of work. And then, you know, the question is, are you going to retrain people so that they have new skills? And, you know, this is why I'm a socialist, because I think, you know, people shouldn't be out of work because technology puts them out of work. You need to, you know, like, society should be about taking care of people instead of taking care of profits first. But in terms of how AI can change society in the longer term, I think we need to start thinking about values, you know, in terms of, right, if we train our AIs to kill people, they will. You know, and I think to some extent, you know, computers are tools, but our AI will start being more like people as we start teaching them rather than programming them. And I think, you know, we have to start thinking about the ethics that's involved with that before the technology gets more powerful than we know what to do with. You know, like, I look at the Skynet stuff in Terminator and I'm just like, I used to think that that was, like, not possible, and now part of me isn't so sure. Like, now that I actually really teach this stuff and how it works, and it might not be, you know, clearly Arnold won't be in it, but some of that stuff is maybe not as fictional as we might imagine, or it, maybe not one day. Any other thoughts on, like, future of AI before we open to the audience? Or the future, how it might affect your industry, or?
No, I listened to, I think it was, I listened to a lot of podcasts. And the most recent one I listened to was, I believe, The Marketplace. And they talked about how technology advances are putting people out of jobs. And, you know, you have people like Zuckerberg and I forgot who else. They're pushing for a universal wage minimum, or not wage, but basically where everybody gets paid a minimum amount, no matter if you're working or not. And so things like that could potentially help, you know, the socialist aspect of taking care of the people, because we're moving so fast as technology that there are people that are going to be left behind. There are people that aren't going to be able to go back to school and understand how to utilize or use the new the technology. And so how do we take care of the people who are left behind? And so I thought that was interesting how they're pushing for basically a universal payment plan to where everybody has some sort of paycheck that comes in. It's not, you know, welfare. It's not, you know, unemployment.
One of the kind of examples that I always come back to is thinking about self-driving cars, and is in particular accidents with self-driving cars. Like, if let's say a self-driving car has the option of like kind of killing five people or one person, like how does that play out? And then I think that for me always comes back to the structures that we have in place as a society. Like, you can't really take a self-driving car to court, you know? It's like, it becomes really difficult, and I think that we need to think about how we evaluate the decisions that computers do make, because what if we have a scenario where, like a society of self-driving cars, where we have maybe just like a small percentage of accidents compared to what we have today with humans driving cars, but still, when they happen, who's responsible? Is it kind of the engineers that built the car, or the programmers that built the software that made it decide? So I think those are some of the issues that I'm interested in, kind of the how does politics follow? How do we kind of evaluate all of these in a broader scale?
It's interesting, Alex Galloway, media theorist at NYU, has this notion that he builds on of algorithmic capture. And it's the notion that algorithms always capture certain things and leaves other things behind. And in this case, at least having a sense that each algorithm has an ethics to it and a value structure. And I think we're so used to thinking that computer programs are outside of ethics, right? But as we're seeing with something like a self-driving car, the decisions you make in programming that algorithm could have huge ethical implications. And if we don't think those things through beforehand, the implications could be kind of rough. I think in regard to today's election climate, right? With Trump's election, we're just learning how social media has massively impacted this last election. Each day we're finding out more of the way in which Russian interests were intertwined with Facebook ads. And I mean, some of this just came out last night, literally. And if we think of social media as increasingly creating a series of sort of collective nervous systems, right? Sort of neuralizing logics whereby we are the neurons in these large distributed brain structures, which are social media platforms, essentially, then I think we're just as a species starting to understand the implications of where sort of AI is going, not merely as a computer program, but as we are becoming AI-ized in a certain sense, where these sort of neural logics are thinking us in a way. Where social media is literally becoming a set of collective nervous systems. But I guess we should open up to the audience. Questions? Thoughts?
Hey, so you were talking about the loss of jobs and like how people adapt and whatnot. Would it be such a bad thing for society to, instead of looking out to say, hey, how do we kind of make sure everyone has a place in the society and has a job and whatever, instead of taking that view, which is kind of thinking of the way history's always worked, some jobs go out, new jobs come in, everything works out, it's a little messy in the middle. Would it be so bad to instead envision a future where the AI does completely, not take over, but take over in the sense of life can kind of go on an autopilot and would free up humans to just only really do passion projects, So instead of fearing the AI kind of taking over, make sure you train the AI right, and then jobs wouldn't really be a thing. Would that be a thing that you think we should work towards, or do you think that's too risky?
Thoughts?
It's hard to say yes or no. I mean, I think if I take the utopian kind of view, then sure. I mean, that sounds great. I don't know how it would work, and I don't think anyone knows, and I don't know how we as a society and like a species would even react to that kind of situation, you know? So I think that it makes it really hard to evaluate. I think, it kind of, I don't even know how to answer this. I think it comes down to kind of the values that we have and then how we start to define those value systems when we no longer have jobs, like how are we gonna structure our lives? I think it's really interesting. So I guess I'm leaning more towards, yes, we could work towards something like that, but I think the implications of that, like actually going towards that, are so huge that I don't even really know what that means. So that's why I'm a little bit cautious with my answer.
I think that we can work towards that to a degree. You know, there's certain jobs, there's certain repetitive jobs that basically you can, you know, hand over to AI, but to teach our kids, you know, you're not gonna have an AI teach our kids. You know, there's a lot of jobs out there that take human interaction. They take, you know, the handshake, that personal interaction that AI is not gonna be able to do. So, you know, taxi drivers, they should probably be scared. I mean, that's a job of, you know, taking me from point A to point B. That's your job. That's a very simple job that AI can do. That's a very menial task. So working towards an area to where AI can do those menial tasks, then I think that's beneficial. But, you know, teaching our kids or, those creating a talk show, you know, being able to, you know, tell the news and things like that with a certain, you know, je ne sais quoi, you know, I can't see that using AI in that sense. Maybe the 1, 2, 3, go, you know, so the cameraman may not have a job, but, you know, the person behind in front of the camera.
I mean, this makes me think of in the 1850s when Marx was, this is way before Karl Marx wrote Das Kapital, he was, it's often referred to as the young Marx, he was a pretty utopian socialist, and he was blown away by these new machines that were, you know, completely revolutionizing industrial production in Europe. And he fantasized that, you know, pretty soon these machines and these factories would bring about a state in which, you know, people wouldn't have to do all the sort of drudgery that they do today. And instead you could, you know, take care of your basic tasks in the morning, and then in the afternoon you could decide if you wanted to go fishing or write poetry. Technology has gone way further in the last 150 years than Marx could have ever dreamed, but so has social inequality. The divide between rich and poor is now greater, I think, than it's ever been. And certainly it seems to be getting worse in the last 20 to 30 years. I know that's been documented. And so I'm not sure that increasing technology is gonna make the world a better place until we're better people. I think right now we're using it really well to exploit each other in all sorts of ingenious ways. So, someone else, questions?
Do you really want to leave it up to a computer to tell you how to feel? I think that's on us. You know, I don't think AI is the mirror that basically says you're a bad person or you're a good person. I think that's on us. You know, we know the difference between right and wrong. It's whether we want to follow that path or not, whichever path, you know, that's on us. I don't see AI being that tool.
Yeah, I think that AI has the potential to do both. I think it really depends on the applications that we decide on, and I think that kind of goes back to your point about who's in charge, like who makes the decisions about how AI is used. And right now it's like big technology companies, so fingers crossed. I don't know. I mean, yeah, I think it has the potential to go in both directions. I think we need to be very aware as consumers and as creators about the companies that go in the direction that we ourselves want to support.
I mean, I think you make both very powerful points here. I think until we are able to have AI that can feel the difference between right and wrong, it's just going to mirror us back in some ways, or perhaps even mirror some of our worst aspects back. You know, like, for example, this Department of Defense neural network I was talking about, all it does is look for patterns of terrorists. It's a little mini brain, and that's all it does. And part of the reason why that's all it does is that it's not connected to a larger rest of a brain or a body. And when humans ask ourselves, like, do I feel that that's moral or ethical, they actually are consulting their body. If you look at sort of the research around how emotions and how feeling states are brought about, it's all these very complex feedback loops between maps in the brain of all the parts of your body, and then your brain releases chemicals to make you feel this way or that in relation to how your body physically reacts to things. So that gut instinct of, am I doing right, am I doing wrong, a lot of the contemporary, you know, I would say cognitive neuroscience, except for it's all about the physiology of the body, the science of emotion basically makes a strong argument that without a body, a brain in and of itself will have no values other than what you teach it. And so if it's ever going to decide right and wrong itself, it needs a body. And then we have to ask the question, do we want our AI to have bodies, and what type?
Right.
And that opens up a can of worms that's, oh my God. So I don't know if that's an answer. Yes.
So I'm a music producer, and I'm curious about the integration or collaboration of humans and artificial intelligence. I don't really see it as being beneficial. Like, I write, like, every part. I don't use loops or anything like that. And using that in music, I feel, is actually like counterproductive when it comes to like the advancement, like holistically, of creative individuals getting better at making music. So, I mean, I'm just trying to, there's a few different points, like where like it kind of seems like maybe it's just like a marketing gimmick, like maybe that you can have people who don't really want to learn how to make music be able to, or like, learn percussion versus like playing the keys or whatever. They can have these instruments created for them without learning themselves. And that seems sort of counterproductive for music producers holistically. So I don't know, I'm curious like whether you see a benefit in it and what the benefit would be by having that rather than teaching, using artificial intelligence to teach people to make music. It seems kind of lazy to me, is what it comes off as.
You're going to have people take shortcuts, you know, you're going to have people that, you know, music is what I want to do, I'll make money, and then I'm going to, you know, use AI to make the music, and then I'm just going to put it out there and do whatever. But the examples I showed you, Alex the Kid, Taryn Southern, they know how to read and write. They know how to play instruments. They know the whole creative process. And so this is a matter of them accepting the new technology and figuring out how to integrate it into their creative process. So it's not necessarily taking the shortcut. It's looking at, you know, part of being creative is trying new things. And so this is them trying new things. But you're always going to have people that are going to try to take the shortcut and not learn how to play piano, or not learn how to do the right song structure, for you know, and typically those are the people that, I wouldn't say that, typically you're not gonna have as good a quality music as someone who has knows the creative process and has labored through that creative process.
That's why I'm saying I think it seems like counterproductive for like people. If that becomes like the norm, then wouldn't the quality of music become less as a result?
I don't know if it's going to be the norm, because I think the idea is, you know, yes, you're taking a shortcut, but you're not putting the effort and the emotion into it as, you know, Alex a kid or more established or more creative types that are creating the programming. You're going to have, I mean, it happens now without AI. You're going to have those songs that you listen to and like, this is trash, but it's number one on the charts. But you're also, you know, that's always been the case with music for years, and that was before AI. But I don't see that the creative process or the creativity from the individuals has changed. You know, you have those artists, those diehard, you know, guitarists or drummers or songwriters, or the case may be. You have companies out there actually teaching the creative process. You know, a buddy of mine is running artist group or artist APG, something like that. But he's looking for people who are hungry enough to create music, and not necessarily, you know, just use the latest and greatest tool out there, but understand the process. This is how you do, you know, step A, step B, step C to get to, you know, the end game. So you're going to have people out there that are going to take shortcuts, but you're also going to have people out there that each one teach one, teaching people how to, you know, explore their creativity and produce quality stuff.
Sandra?
Thank you very much.
Oh, I guess we're out of time. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, you didn't get to...
That's okay.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thank you.